Hey everybody, welcome back. I'm Wayne Baker, one of the staff therapists with Affair Recovery. And this week we're gonna be talking about a question that I hear, it seems like almost daily, sometimes a couple of times a day it seems, and that is, were you thinking about me, or were they thinking about me when your spouse was having their affair? I can't tell you the number of couples that have come through my office or even through Affair Recovery. And it's such a common question. There's too many examples to really be specific about, but it happens all the time. And if you're in this situation, you know that that's one of the questions that you have asked your spouse maybe 100 times, and you've asked your therapist, were they thinking about me? And the hard and really simple truth is probably not. The unfaithful spouse really typically isn't thinking about their mate. And when it becomes known, the tension can really escalate between the two of you because it's really hard to hear that. Now, no two situations are exactly alike. And I just want to remind you that what I'm about to share and talk about by no means justifies any type of betrayal. Hopefully you know me by now that that's a pretty hard line that I stand on. But we ask these questions, and so we have to take a good, long, hard, honest look at them. And hopefully as we discuss this topic, it'll lead you both to a deeper level of understanding about why and how and all the justifications of about what happened. But here are some of my observations over the years. So when the unfaithful is with their affair partner, they rarely think about their spouse. But what's probably even more painful is the fact that when they're at home with their mate, they frequently are thinking about the affair partner because they want to escape life and the demands and the responsibilities that they have. So they may be thinking more and more about the affair partner there. And before I go on, I just want to make sure for the unfaithful spouse that you can ask yourself and be honest with yourself about, are you ready for the challenge of understanding the painful dynamics of infidelity? It will challenge, I believe, almost everything you know or thought you knew about intimate relationships. And part of the danger for me of recording these newsletters is that my use of some broad, sweeping statements and stereotypes and generalities can trigger some people, but those exist for a reason because it hits a broad spectrum. I acknowledge some of that up front and that there is some of that in this newsletter, but please remember, just take what works for you and leave the rest. Like I said earlier, there's no two situations that are exactly alike, but over the years, these are the trends that we've seen. And I want to say one more time, I'm not condoning or excusing anyone's infidelity by the explanations that follow. Here's what I believe, is that we cheat because we're unhealthy. There's a ton of things we could have done rather than have an affair, but we weren't brave enough to do them. For most of the betrayed spouses, it's really difficult to fully grasp and understand their spouse's explanation because of what we called assumed similarities. You see, what we do is we only can judge or understand another's motives by what it would mean if we did the exact same thing. And you see that playing out through infidelity recovery all the time. For instance, if you're not prone to pain avoidance, then it might be really difficult for you to understand why some people might drink or get high or even look at porn to avoid some pain and to escape. So today, I hope to provide you, the betrayed spouse, with a perspective that might help you genuinely understand what's going on in the mind of your unfaithful spouse. This kind of understanding can be a milestone in bringing clarity and healing, and hopefully even some peace of mind as we walk through this together. The hard truth is that affairs are about escaping. My hope is to bring at least some much-needed insight to the most difficult and painful situation that you didn't ask for. Having said that, I've been doing this for 15 years and worked with close to 1,000 couples. And the majority of the unfaithful spouses that I work with have reported thinking about their affair partner when they were with their mate, but rarely thinking about their mate when they're with the affair partner. And sometimes the unfaithful spouse reports that they think of their mate when with the affair partner, but only focus on the things they dislike or are angry about to help them push their guilt feelings away about what they're doing. While this is really disturbing to the betrayed spouse, I believe it helps explain a dynamic that's frequently present in the unfaithful spouse. I also want to say that it's also not true in every case. Affairs, as well as many other acts of infidelity, often serve as a way of escape. They provide the distraction, a fantasy, if you will, by allowing the unfaithful spouse to escape the pressures and the realities of life and the feelings of inadequacy. Unfortunately, in that moment, little or no thought is given to the impact of their actions. They are solely focused on what they stand to gain. Escape, approval, affection, and the list goes on. But rarely does anyone consider in the moment why they are doing what they're doing or how will it affect everyone else in their life. Typically, their only thought is, I'll never get caught, or I'll work really hard so I don't get caught. They don't consider what it must inevitably cost their spouse or their family, or what they could do to improve their existing relationship, since they're only thinking of themselves. To say that infidelity is self-absorbed and selfish is really a colossal understatement. Remember, I was the unfaithful one in my marriage 25 years ago. And I hope this doesn't sound like I'm throwing stones, but I just want you to remember that I've been there, and most of what I've learned about myself in the process took years of work. It took years of individual therapy and some couples therapy, some group therapy, some 12-step work, and lots of deep spiritual work. It takes a lot of work is really what I'm trying to say, and it takes time, and you can't be passive about it. You have to jump in there with both feet. When it comes to relationships, it's impossible to find someone capable of meeting all your needs or someone who needs you can fully meet. You may love your mate and be content in the relationship, but we're two separate individuals making sacrifices and compromises to live together. If, however, we're underinvested, then we won't value the relationship to the same degree. With the lack of values comes then this lack of motivation to protect and work through the difficulties of marriage and truthfully, any long-term committed relationship. Instead of maintaining an attitude of love and care as we vowed to do once upon a time, we betray ourselves first by abandoning love and abandoning ourselves and becoming more self-centered. Remember, you've probably heard Rick say many times that whatever captures our attention captures us. And as we focus on our spouse's failures, we lose sight of how we are failing our mate and our family as well. So we move into self-deception and we praise our own values, we minimize our own faults, and we falsely believe that we deserve better. Typically, we make it our spouse's fault that we're cheating, as we're forced to go outside of the marriage to get our needs met. I hope you're beginning to see this warped logic here. Life is not about getting our needs met in someone else, because ultimately, an affair partner can't do it either. They can't do it for you, and you won't be able to do it for them very long. And you'll repeat this cycle over and over and over again. I've seen it so many times. External fixes rarely work. The work is in here. It may be hard to fathom, but most unfaithful spouses don't really want to leave their marriage. They do try to escape their reality at the expense of their spouse through the activities of their secret life. But if they are trying to escape reality through the illusions created by an extramarital affair, then they do not want to burst their fantasy bubble by thinking about their spouse. Thinking of their marriage only destroys the illusion and kills the buzz or the secondary gain of their fantasy. They're trying to escape what they believe are the pressures of life and marriage and their unmet needs, while also trying to silence all the voices of fear and shame and guilt that they live with each and every day. So why stop that fantastical way of life if it's the drug that they're using to escape reality? Ultimately, the illusions we create through fantasy and acting out reveal what's broken about us, not what's wrong with our spouse. And what I believe is that much of recovery is based on learning to see our own issues rather than those of our spouse. Because when we get triggered by our spouse, or anyone else for that matter, it's our stuff. And it's a trailhead for where we need to go do our next piece of work. Couples that successfully navigate the dark waters of infidelity work hard to see the overall patterns of self-deception and conflict avoidance and their own reaction to the stresses of everyday life. The unfaithful spouse must be the guardian, the protector of the relationship for a season. The betrayed begins to understand that the infidelity was not their fault. And they probably have other things to work on, but probably later in the process, but they will come to understand, hopefully sooner than later, that the infidelity was not about them. That's one of the key things that I want to tell you, the unfaithful spouse. I don't care what happens or what they say, it was not about you. And I just want to say that for both of you, as you come to understand the why behind the betrayal and any personal issues and past traumas that get addressed, you both will begin to have a little sense of hope that things can change. And in the beginning, at least, it feels so painfully slow that change comes, but it's slow. The unfaithful, if they lead the way and help the spouse feel cared for and safe again, and they demonstrate that they are thinking about someone else besides themselves, really is helpful. So if you're still searching for the why, maybe this has helped a little bit to give you a little bit more insight. As I've said before, all the above mentioned reasons are in no way an excuse for betrayal of any kind. However, I do hope it serves as a reminder that the great relationships aren't just based on the right circumstances, but usually based on a lot of hard work. If you and your spouse are still looking for some support and some help in the recovery of an infidelity or a sexual addiction, I would really love it if you would consider joining us just outside of Austin for an EMS weekend. We do those once a month, and there's a link to them on the website. They fill up quickly. So I just invite you to go take a look at that program and strongly consider it. My sense is that it puts couples anywhere from 4 to 6 months down the road in those three very intensive days. I won't kid you about that. But we get such good feedback from those weekends, and we've been doing them for over a decade. So please consider that. Thank you so much for joining me, and I'll see you guys again next week.